Good morning. Welcome to this 11 o'clock service here at Pleasant View Church. We welcome one and all. Members, welcome. Guests, if you're visiting with us, we hope you'll find this a warm and welcoming congregation. And we invite you to look at our bulletin and all the inserts for the various things going on at the church. Have just a few announcements for you. One is there should be a pew pad on one or the other end of your pew. If you would take that, record your attendance, and share it with your neighbor. We're asking everybody to fill those out so we'll know who's here, and we appreciate your cooperation in that matter. For those who are writing a note to the serve members, please get your letters here by July 25th. There is a box out in the narthex where you can bring it by the church office. And please look over the note in the insert in your bulletin about the backpack program and see where you might want to help. This morning, we had a large group here from Redbird, going to Redbird Mission in Kentucky to do some mission work. And we certainly pray their safe travels and good service this week. Are there any other announcements that we have this morning? Seeing none, if you would, please stand and we'll do our call to worship. It's printed in your bulletin and will probably also be on the screen. Lord, when times are tough, we need the power and energizing fire of your Spirit. Bring to the anxious a steady peace. Bring to the lonely a sense of your nearness.
Opening hymn this morning is Glory Be to God on High. You may look at that and say, well, I don't know that. If you need the music, it's in your bulletin insert. If you simply want to follow the words on the screen, you may do that as well. You'll know the tune. If you know Michael, Row Your Boat Ashore, you got it. And let us join together. This hymn takes us through the life of Jesus, through his birth, through his life, through his death, through his resurrection. And we end each stanza by singing, Glory be to God on high. Let's sing together. Thank you.
let us confirm our faith using the Apostles' Creed. So, Christians, what do you believe? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day He arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sat at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
We join now in singing, "We Are Climbing Jacob's Ladder." Our call to prayer this morning, Jesus, remember me. Thank you.
always appreciate this time that we have as a congregation to share our celebrations and concerns. I'm going to share a celebration that I have this morning. I appreciate the opportunity to worship with folks who have servant hearts. We had a group from Redbird this morning. They keep coming back and back every time they come through here. And there were people that got up, I know, at 5 o'clock this morning, 6 o'clock, to prepare food to bring in to share with those people. It would be easy for people to say, I don't have time to do that, or that's not really my job. But the church here, and I don't say this in a bragging fashion, I say it in a spirit of thankfulness that we worship with people that have that heart. And we'll have the same thing when the served people come in a couple of weeks. But we feed them for a whole week. And people don't say, well, I don't know if we can do that. That's a big undertaking. No, they just jump right in and it gets done. So I'm thankful for a church that has a servant's heart. Do we have other celebrations this morning? If not, do we have prayer concerns that you'd like to lift up? Yes. That's certainly something we need to keep in our prayers. Others? Not seeing any. I have a prayer list this morning. Wesley Kidd, Blake McKinney, David and Barbara Ferris, Virginia Brown, Diane Holloway and family. And I forgot to make this announcement earlier, but in reference to that, there'll be a memorial service for Steve here at Pleasant View on July 28th at 6 p.m. We don't have information about visitation yet, but July 28th at 6 p.m. Gene Sherrill, we have a mission group that is currently in Africa, and of course those people that worshiped with us this morning on their way to Redbird Mission. We want to keep all those in our prayer. There's a more extensive prayer list in your bulletin. Seeing no other concerns, let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Dear God, you have promised us that where two or three are gathered in your name, you're right in the midst. That always brings a sense of awe to all of us when we realize that the eternal God is right here with us and is present with us in our worship service. And God, when we came in here this morning, God knew each of us by name. It's not some generic, hey, all of you come and go to church. He speaks to us individually. And he's concerned about, you're concerned about what happens in our lives. And for that, we give you thanks. We read a call to worship this morning that speaks to us in very meaningful terms and in real life experiences. Because there are people out there in the congregation that are going through tough times right now. It may be a problem with a relationship. It may be health problems. It may be financial problems. So, Lord, when times are tough, you're there with us. So we claim the power and energizing fire of your Spirit. Give us a new confidence to be bold and not fearful. And we need that steady peace that you give us, that sustaining peace, not just for this moment, but throughout our lives. Because no matter what we're facing today, you're with us, and you know our problems, and you're there to comfort and guide us if we'll only seek your Holy Spirit's comfort and guidance. There are people out there that feel lonely. There are people that are in a crowd who have all kinds of friends who still feel lonely. And then there are those people that live on the street that really are in a true sense of loneliness. So bring to those people a sense of community. Bring to those a feeling of family. because we give you thanks for that family here that we call Pleasant View. So, Lord, embolden us, empower us, and encourage us to go out into the world and be that beacon of hope the world so badly needs. The people that need to hear that good word, Jesus loves you. Jesus died for you. Jesus came back from the dead and will reign again forever and ever. They need to hear that, Lord, and let us be bold enough to proclaim it. We raise all these prayer concerns we have up for you this morning. There are situations in the world. There are flooding situations due to the rains we had. There are people who are going without food. We just pray for your peace and your will be done on this earth. We pray for our military and for our first responders. Lord, we love you because you first loved us. And we pray that prayer now together that you taught us so long ago. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. If our ushers would come forward,
for just a second. Would you stand up? One of the things I enjoy about coming to Pleasant View, and I don't get to come that often, is hearing you sing. And you haven't been singing much this morning. I don't know if you didn't know those songs or if you were just timid, but I know a song that I know you know. And it always gets me excited, so I'm hoping it'll get you excited before we hear this wonderful sermon that I've already heard this morning. I know it's good. Sing with me. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. Sing it. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior. All the day long. Amen. You may be seated. That sounded like Pleasant View. In a God wrote His love on the hillside so long, long ago. For you and for me, Jesus died and love's greatest story. I love you.
God, we're such a blessed people. You blessed us with resources and with talents and gifts. And God, we just give you thanks when people are willing to share those for the upbuilding of your kingdom. And we know you love a cheerful giver. Now use these gifts for the upbuilding of your kingdom as only you can do. In your powerful name we pray. Amen.
Morning, friends. How are we this morning? Good. Now, does anybody ever have a dream? You had a dream. What was your dream about?
Paw Patrol.
Paw Patrol.
What else do we have dreams about?
My dream is Pokemon.
Pokemon? Did you have a... Wait, I heard... Now, James, did you say you have scary dreams sometimes?
Oh.
And they make us really scared. And what did you tell me, Tucker? Do you have silly dreams? Scary dreams?
Oh, no.
What, Miss Rosemary? You had a corn dream, so that sounds fun.
I'm like,
yes, sir. You can't tell them? Can't remember them? They're scary? After all, Mike. Okay, so sometimes we forget our dreams, right? Now, did you know that God chooses to speak to some people through their dreams? That's one of the ways he can talk to people. And in our scripture lesson this morning, he is going to talk to Jacob through a dream. Now, I wasn't with you last Sunday at 11 o'clock, but did you learn about this guy named Jacob? The two brothers? What? You must have been paying attention. There was a birthright involved, right? And did one steal the other one's birthright? Yes, that Jacob, he's tricky. That Jacob, he's tricky. What can I tell you about this dream? So this morning, Jacob is going to lay down, and he has a dream. And he's made his brother Esau really mad. And he's left home. And in this dream, you want to hear what happens? There's a ladder. What? Exactly, to heaven. And, oh wait, you got the preview version, didn't you? Let me tell you about Jacob's dream. With angels going up and down, and then there's God in his dream. And God makes a couple promises to Jacob. Well, not quite the rainbow, not different promise. So God makes a promise to Jacob. Now, does God keep his promises?
Yes.
Yes, he does. Just sometimes or all the time?
All the time.
And while Jacob doesn't really understand, he can't quite see how God's really going to work all this out yet, but we know that God keeps his promises. And guess what? He keeps his promises to Jacob, too. Would you guys pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for today. Thank you for keeping your promises. We love you, Lord. Amen.
This morning. Let me try that again now that my microphone is on. Our scripture lesson this morning is from Genesis chapter 28. I'll be reading verses 10 through 17. If you're able, I invite you to stand with me as we show reverence to the reading of scripture. Now Jacob left Beersheba and went toward Haran. And he came to a certain place and stayed there that night because the sun had set. taking one of the stones of the place, he put it under his head and lay down in that place to sleep. And he dreamed. And behold, there was a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it reached to heaven. And behold, the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord, the God of Abraham your father and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie I will give to you and to your offspring. Your offspring shall be like the dust of the earth, and you shall spread abroad to the west and to the east and to the north and to the south. And in you and your offspring shall all the families of the earth be blessed. Behold, I am with you, and will keep you wherever you go, and will bring you back to this land. For I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Then Jacob awoke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it. And he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. This is the word of God for the people of God, and we say together, thanks be to God. Please be seated. Steve got out of college, and life seemed to be going really well for him. He got that first job, and then right away he got a promotion. He was making money. He was living the good life, but something was missing. Steve decided it was time to settle down and find a wife. He shared that with some of his buddies, and so they decided that if Steve was going to find a wife, they needed to go hang out where the ladies were hanging out in the city. And so they all dressed up and went out one night. And Steve and his buddies were scanning the room looking for Steve's perfect woman. They looked at this one and that one, no, that, no, no, no. And then right there, that was the woman. She checked every box on Steve's list. And so his friend said, well, you need to go over there and talk to her instead of sitting here planning on marrying her. So he went over and talked with her, and I mean, the closer he got, the more radiant she was. Just this beautiful young woman. And so he went over and began talking with her, and finally he mustered up the nerve to say to her, would you go on a date with me? And she looked at him and she said, no, I don't think so. And he said, well, do you mind telling me why not? And she said, I'll be happy to tell you. She said, number one, you're overweight. Number two, your hairline is thinning. And number three, your wardrobe is atrocious. He said, so if I fix those things, you'll go out with me. She said, well, we'll see. So he left, he went, and he joined the gym. He went to work, and he started losing weight. He joined the men's hair club, and they thickened up his hair and made his hair look good again. He went and found the best tailor in town and had all the right clothes cut to fit him. And a year later, he goes back to that same place, and there is that same woman. But Steve's a different guy. 80 pounds lighter. He's had his teeth whitened. He's had his tan sprayed on. He's wearing nice clothes. And he goes up and starts a conversation with this woman. And he can tell that things are going better than they did the last time. And finally, he says to her, would you go on a date with me? And she said, are you kidding? You're the best-looking man in this place. Of course I'd go on a date with you. And so they worked out all the details. He showed up, flowers in hand. He had hired a limo and a driver for the evening.
He ushered her out to the limo. They went and had this wonderful dinner. The conversation was great. Everything was going beautifully. They get back out in the limo. They stop at this place and that place because if you're in a limo, you're in a limo to be seen, and you have to stop places and get in and out. And so they'd been to a couple places. She was laughing at his jokes. Everything was going beautifully. He gets out of the limo, and just out of random, on a beautiful night, suddenly a lightning bolt falls from heaven, hits him square on the head, and he falls to the pavement. He looks up to the sky and says, "Lord, how could you? On the most wonderful night of my life, how could you let this happen?" And the Lord said, "I'm sorry, Steve. I didn't recognize you." We're going to talk about a story this morning where God recognized Jacob, but Jacob wasn't fully recognizing God. He wasn't fully grasping what was going on. In fact, at the end of the story, as I've read it, Jacob said, "God was here, and I missed it. I didn't get it." Let's back up and talk about last week. We talked about Jacob stealing his birthright from his brother by catching him at a time when he was vulnerable and by outmaneuvering him. And today, we get a story of Jacob on the run because guess what? He has stolen his brother's blessing that he was to receive from the father, the symbol of the covenant blessing of God that had passed from Abraham to Isaac and was supposed to go to Esau, but went to Jacob because of trickery and deception. Jacob outsmarted his slower, dumber brother. But the one thing that Jacob did not consider was that he had left his brother with nothing to lose. And that's a dangerous place to be. And so Esau made a vow, "By this time tomorrow, my brother will be a dead man. I'm going to kill him." Jacob's mother hurriedly got him ready and sent him away. Go to Haran, hundreds of miles away on foot. Hide out there with my family until I send you word that it's safe to come back. And so Jacob ran for his life. And he ran. And he ran. I'm certain running across that hot desert, every time he heard a noise, he looked around. Was Esau following him? Was this when he was going to catch up with him and kill him? And so Jacob just kept moving and running and moving and running until it got too dark to see. Jacob had to go to sleep for the night. Now, I have some things that really matter to me and bring me comfort. And one of those things is my pillow. I don't care where I go, my pillow goes with me. You know? I mean, when you got a baby, you load up the diaper bag and take all their stuff, right? Well, when I go, I take my pillow with me because I like my pillow. Jacob got to his resting place that night with two things: his coat and his staff, his walking stick. And so he found a stone, and there he laid his head. I want you to think about this for a minute. We would call Jacob a trust fund baby today. he inherited the riches of Abraham, the riches of Isaac. He was one of the wealthiest men on the planet. And here he is in the middle of nowhere with nothing but his coat and his walking stick and a stone for a pillow. And he had done it to himself. There was nobody else to blame. Jacob had been so smart that he had been really stupid. And there he was with nothing. He'd been running all day and he had to go to sleep. During his sleep, he began having this vivid, memorable dream of a ladder from earth to heaven. Angels moving up and down the ladder. Messengers of God bringing a message of comfort to Jacob. And finally, God himself speaking to Jacob. This conniver, schemer, bargainer, now a man running for his life in the middle of nowhere, is met by God himself. I am the Lord, God says, the God of your father Abraham, the God of Isaac. And then he says to Jacob, I'm your God too. I want you to look around. Can you measure the grains of dust on the floor of this desert? Because if you can number the grains of sand and dust, that's how numerous your offspring will be. Look in every direction, to the north, to the south, to the east, to the west. All of this land, even the land where you're laying right now, this will all be yours. God said to the man who had nothing but the clothes on his back and the stick that he used for walking, this will all be yours. And I will be with you. And I will protect you until you come again to your father's house in safety. And Jacob woke up and said, wow, God was here and I missed it. Well, he didn't miss it. He just didn't realize the sacred space that he was in. God was all around him. God was with him. God was his protection. The stone on which he had laid Jacob set up, it went from being a pillow to being a pillar. Now, those of you raised hillbilly like me know that there's really little difference between a pillar and a pillar, but the pillow that he laid on was set up then to be a sacred pillar. That would become the city of Bethel, a sanctuary city in Israel one day. Bethel, in Hebrew, pronounced Bethel, the house of God. there God had shown up. And God had promised Jacob, I will be with you. Just as I was with your ancestors, I will be with you. God sent the prophets later to say to errant Israel, I will be with you. The Son of God shared with his disciples before he left the earth, I will be with you even until the end of the age. God's promise is, I will be with you. We would expect this to be a turning point for Jacob. The point at which he sang, I surrender all, and truly surrendered all. But Jacob wasn't there yet. No, Jacob's response, by the way, don't ever put a cough drop in the wool blazer. It doesn't work real well. Jacob's response was, Lord, if you'll bring me back, if you'll protect me, if you'll get me back to my father's house in safety, then you will be my God and I will pay a tithe to you. Do you hear a bargain in that? God has said, Jacob, I'm yours unconditionally. And Jacob has said, God, here are my conditions, here's my list, here's my plan. If you do all of this, you can be my God. Does anybody see anything a little lopsided in Jacob's thinking? But then I have to begin thinking about the times that I've presented God my list. You know, Lord, this is the way I want it all to unfold. Lord, if you will make this happen, then I'll do this. And if you'll make that happen, I'll do that. And Lord, if you'll just spare this person I love, I'll do anything you want me to do. Yeah, we've all been there, haven't we? We've all tried to bargain with God. Just do this, Lord, and then I'll follow you without condition. Didn't work for Jacob, and friends, it won't work for us because, you see, God is already all in. He gave his son. He gave his life. God is already all in. The promise is already there. I'll be with you. The promise is already there. I'll forgive you. The promise is already there. I'll pick you up and clean you off and get you headed in the right direction. The promise is already there. You can't push me away because my love for you is never in question. God did not give up on Jacob. And God is not going to give up on you either. And let me give you a little insight. It'll go a whole lot better if you'll just go ahead and do it God's way, starting right now. Let's pray. Lord, forgive us when we hand you our list and make our conditional promises. Remind us that you gave it all for us. Lord, now, in our heart of hearts, we offer those hearts back to you. We offer everything that we have, everything that we are. take us and use us, because you know better than we where we need to be and what we need to do. So, Lord, we are yours. Amen. Let us stand together and sing our closing hymn, Wonderful Words of Life. Go now in His peace. May the grace of Christ, our Savior, and the Father's boundless love, and the Holy Spirit's favor rest upon us from above, both now and even forevermore. Amen.